Thank you. Yes, as you mentioned, thank you for the nice words. My name is Rix Schlaski. I'm from Continental Automotive, and I would like to present you the Eclipse eCar proposal, a middleware that is developed at Continental over the last years. And yeah, I have the pleasure and the pressure to be the first. I hope this will work. That's me. So a few words about myself. I was studying in 1997. Electrical engineering at the Technical University of Dresden, and I have a long career in the automotive industry. Even it looks that I worked all the time for Continental, it's not that true. I started at Alfred Tavis GmbH and then later IDT Automotive and then Continental, but I was never leaving my office more or less because they were all finally bought by Continental. I was dealing with different pre-development R&D projects, mainly anti-lock braking systems, rapid prototyping HMIs, and also middleware development for AD systems like eCar that I want to present today. And today my official role is I'm leading a strategic development framework at Continental for the innovation line driverless. Yes. eCar, what does it mean? So this is the official statement from the eCar homepage. eCar, Enhanced Communication Abstraction Layer, is a fast publish subscribe middleware that can manage inter-process data exchange as well as inter-host communication. That is still true, but this is a very early statement, and in the meanwhile, eCar is much more. eCar has an ecosystem and is used widely also in other projects for AI or robotic. I will show you more details later on. First of all, about the motivation. So why did we start this crazy idea to develop a new middleware? Let me show you the motivation behind eCar. So 8 or 10 years before, when the autonomous driving projects came to the pre-development of Continental, we faced a lot of changes. So that was really challenging us. We needed to use high-performance computers, as also new sensor technologies were introduced, like cameras, radars, and lidars, and all these sensors are producing a large quantity of data, and this data needs to be transferred very efficient, very fast, and needs to be also processed in real time. So we needed to distribute our software components in the car. That means the components are running now on different process cores. They run on different domain controllers, and they also run on different operating systems. And besides this, the whole approach is going in the direction of a data-centric approach. That means all data flows need to be monitored, recorded, and also finally prepared for post-processing analysis. So, yeah, what about existing solutions? For sure, at the beginning when we started, we checked the market for existing solutions. And 2015 and earlier, there was the robot operating system Generation 1. We really loved the API from ROS 1, and it's true, we inspired a lot of the API from eCar from the system. But unfortunately, this time, the overall performance from ROS 2 was not fulfilling our requirements. It was based on TCP only, and it was not fitting to our AD performance projects. The next systems that we also evaluated were data distribution services. So yeah, we checked a lot of systems like OpenSplice and RTI Connect, and they have different drawbacks for our use cases. Some of them were really slow, some of them were quite expensive, they were complex to build this time, and so we really were going in the direction to just create a small communication core called eCar in 2015. But what is the situation today? Today, the robot operating system ROS 2 is existing. It has the same simple, nice API like ROS 1. But in addition to this, it has a very powerful so-called ROS middleware concept. That means it can integrate other communication stacks for the communication backbone. That means with ROS 2, we have the possibility to integrate a DDS system, for example. And we can also then benefit from shared memory transport. There are open source alternatives, and Windows is supported as well now. So the question is, what distinguishes eCar from ROS 2 today? I would like to focus on three things. First of all, ECAL is message protocol agnostic. That means there is no ECAL message system or ECAL IDL, but we can use different standard protocols from the market, like Google Protobuf, Flatbuffers, JSON, things like that. So we can always choose the best fitting protocol for our use case. Always the issue with the message schema evaluation is very important for our use cases. So in the rapid prototyping phase, interfaces are often changing all the time, and we need a message transport system that can ensure up and downwards compatibility in a way that we can use older measurements also in the future, or that we can change one or two software components without breaking the compatibility. The next point is ECAL is not an ecosystem. ECAL is more a library. So it's pure C++. It has a CMake build system. It has some dependencies. And the ECAL core itself is very minimalistic. It is easy to build, easy to extend, and has almost zero conf configuration. That means we can apply this core functionality on a lot of different targets. And last not least, over the last years, ECAL has got a lot of powerful additional tools. So we have one tool, it's called ECAL Monitor. I show it later in a demo that can give you all can visualize all the data flows, can make protocol reflections to show in the messages, look in the messages, and it has plugin concepts to add additional plugins for complex message types like images, point clouds, and things like that. And another unique selling point for ECAL very often is the distributed recording concept I will show later. So now let's go more in technical detail. I would like to give you an architectural overview. As mentioned, ECAL is supporting Windows operating systems and POSIX systems as well. That means it's running on embedded Linux systems, on standard Ubuntu distributions, and also on QNX in a stable release. It's supporting different message protocols, transport protocols for the message transport. That means for the local communication, for the so-called inter-process communication, it is using shared memory. It can also use ISOX, by the way, via CMake configuration. And for inter-host communication, it's using UDP multicast or TCP in the latest version. As mentioned, it is supporting different serialization formats. Most of our AD systems are running on top of Google Protobuf, but there are use cases where other protocols are fitting better, like flat buffers for nested data types or JSON if you need some human readable format. And last not least, there is the communication pattern layer. That means we are providing two communication patterns. One is publish-subscribe. That is, from my perspective, the most powerful one and used in almost 90% of the use cases. And additionally, there is a server-client pattern that can be used for specific software components like parameter server or to synchronize components and things like that. Worth to mention is ECAL is brokerless. That means there's no daemon application in the background. There's no connection maker or something like this. All the handling, all the connection management discovery is done by every single software component itself. On top of this communication pattern, there are the language bindings. So in the meanwhile, ECAL itself is developed in C++, but it has bindings to C language, to C#, Python, Rust, Go, and also very nice Simulink toolbox where you can directly communicate with Simulink models out of the box. As mentioned, ECAL is chipped with so-called ecosystem tools. The most powerful one for the first in Betrieb number for set up the car is the live monitoring tool, the ECAL Monitor. He can show you all connections, frequencies, data sizes, data types, and things like that. The next one is the distributed message recording, the ECAL Recorder. This is a very specific application that is allowing you to record all data flows without interfering the network of the car. That means on every single host, there is a running ECAL service, ECAL recording service, and this service is orchestrated by a central application and synchronized so that if you stop recordings, the data are not going out of your host, but going directly to a local mass storage. there's another software for sure to replay all these measurements for post-processing, and there's one tool called eCalSys where you can start and stop a whole system or make a snapshot of a system and restart a system in the same way again. All tools are realized as GUI applications, as user-friendly Qt GUI application, but also they are provided as command line applications so that you can automate your setup in your vehicle and doing batch processing and things like that. Last not least, code first. eCal is open sourced by Continental under Apache 2 in 2019. And over this open sourcing process, we got a lot of new customers. This is really interesting, which also are using this software in sometimes very interesting ways. Finally, I would like to show you two typical use cases. The first one, for sure, is an autonomous communication stack for AD vehicles. What you can see here is in this demo setup, we have five machines running. One is a normal development PC from a user. Then we have a speed code running QNX. We have two parts of an NVIDIA Drive device, and we have a standard multi-core HPC running Ubuntu 20. And on top of these machines, on every single machine, eCal is deployed as communication core, so that the running software components on top do not need to know any specific operating system APIs or functionalities. They can concentrate just on publishing and subscribing informations. In the middle, you see the eCal tools running. So there are services. Three services are started for recording for these NVIDIA devices and for the multi-core HPC. And between software components and eCal, there's also an additional very typical sensor abstraction layer where over specific gateways, the CAN communication, for example, or the camera and radar interfaces are wrapped into eCal interfaces so that the software components can access all these informations in the same way. A typical use case is you drive your car on the test center and make some recordings, and finally you want to validate your software components. The good news is this is quite simple. So you can just take another machine. You can also run everything on one machine. Here we have two machines, a control PC and a Ubuntu HPC. You deploy your software components on this single machine, and then easily you can use the eCal player, command line or GUI application, load the distributed recording that is collected by the recorder to one large HDF5 data set, and stimulate the software components. In this way, there's an image published and also a GPS position, and so the lane detection can create a lane, send it to the localization module, and this is finally calculating a priceless localization for the driving functions. Additionally, you can start the eCal monitor, for example. This is also can also subscribe all these informations, and in specific plugins, this monitor is able then to visualize these informations in a fancy way. This is all Cree theory, and last but not least, I would show you a live demo, a recorded live demo, and I try to synchronize this in real time. So let's see how is eCal acting on a standard setup. So first of all, I would like to start three components. A classical person publisher that is publishing a protobuf message called person. This is a classic eCal example. And two subscribers. Okay, let's see. Should start now? Okay. So yeah, this is the person publisher. As you can see, it's publishing something. And now I start two subscribers, and immediately they start communicating with on the fly and connecting to the person publisher. You can see the logout of this Google protobuf message. I can stop the publisher, restart the publisher, and they will reconnect immediately. This is also working in Python script language, so let's check a Python script that is subscribing on the same information. As you can see here, this is a simple protobuf subscriber in Python, subscribing person, and in a few lines of code, it should print out the message too. Yeah, it's working. I know that's working. It's recorded. That's good news. So now I would start the eCal monitor. And this monitor is now showing on this machine there are four components running, four software components are running. They are all working with Pearson. One is publishing and the other three are subscribing. And you see the layer, this is also monitored, they all use shared memory. And if I double click on such information, then a specific protobuf reflection plugin is started because it's protobuf and the monitor recognizes this format and I can have a live preview on the content. Also in raw data for for specific nerds, but the protobuf reflection for sure is a better one. Now to show you the recorder, I close all the subscriptions and just start the recording application to record all topics on this host. Let's see, there's only one topic person, but in any way it's the same technique for 100 topics or for only one topic. So there's a person topic. I pre-configured everything in the recorder, so this is the default behavior. I start the recording and the recording is running now and writing these frames in HDF5 format to my hard disk. Yeah. After stopping, there should be a new measurement now on my machine in this standardized ECAL measurement folder. This can be configured. Here you see the measurement layout. There's one host and there's one HDF5 file, so not that much information. I double click on the recording and the player is starting and now I see in this recording there's one topic person and I can replay it. And immediately the monitor is showing the player GUI also as ECAL application and I can start the protobuf reflection again and I see the same content that was recorded before. I also can start another subscriber again and he will connect on the fly. The ECAL player allows me to control this. I can start and stop and I can also go stepwise for this channel and do debugging or things like that, forward and backward. Backward makes not so much sense, but at least forward. And besides the simple use case, I would also open a real AD measurement that we made, this brand new, on our location in Frankfurt. So this measurement is around 130 seconds. It has 154 channels, but it's replayed by the player the same way like our simple person demo. So I can start a replay here of this measurement, and in the monitor we should see now 150 published topics by the player. Here we are. We can sort them. And yeah, you see they are all encoded in protobuf. There are the frequencies and the data clocks. And if I double click on this break topic, for example, I should see the content in protobuf again. These plugins for the monitor are also existing for other formats like Cape and Proto or Flatbuffer. So in this use case, we just use protobuf. And if I have more advanced topics like images or point clouds, I can also do a reflection here. And if the monitor is finding a fitting plugin for this specific protobuf type, then he is integrating this visualization in the standard reflection view. And I see camera images and can also control them from the player now because I can also define the step channel, that means the channel where the player should synchronize the measurement on, and then I can go stepwise forward for this specific topic. Yeah, and that's it more or less from the demo, I think. Okay, everything's closing, fine. So yeah, the interesting thing is the raw data, yet, but also this image can be shown as protobuf reflection, as you can see. So you see at least the wrapping protobuf message type with width and high, and there's a plop where the pixels are in, and this plop is then interpreted by this protobuf, by this visualization plugin. Okay. To summarize this, so there are a lot of solutions for publish-subscribe communication, for sure, different ones. ECAL was especially designed for autonomous driving applications, and it has some nice feature like standardized message support. It has modern communication patterns like publish-subscribe and client-server, and is especially developed for the needs and for the performance of such distributed systems. It provides also these powerful tools, and all the tools are available in different interfaces, command line, GUI application, but also as the C++ library interface. So you can integrate these tools in your own environment, with your own language. And ECAL finally is open source since 2019. And the ECAL team and me, we are looking forward to be part of this Eclipse family. Thank you for your attention.
Great, thanks, Rex. So
I was just too fast.
Say again?
I was too fast.
No, that's fine. We start a little bit early, so we're perfect in time. I would be happy if everyone would be on spot like you. Just to make the online participants aware that we are listening to their questions, I would like to start, and there are a couple of questions in the chat. I would like to ask to start with an online question. Does ECAL support PCI transfer?
No. No, ECAL supports shared memory transport, but not this specific low-level PCI interface, no.
Okay. Then I will have a second question from the chat, and then we'll ask for a question all in the room. Are the services only accessible via command line interface or HMI? Is it possible to build up on service API, for example, for the ECAL recorder?
Yes. All these command line tools, not the command line tools, the GUI applications, they have their own RPC interface, so you can automate and control them completely with the service interface, yes.
Okay, so then I would try to find out if there are any questions here in the on-site audience. Unfortunately, I need to run, because we would like the online participants to hear their questions as well. And I'm, meanwhile, a little bit aged, so I'm not the fastest one. Oh, sorry, then I misunderstood. Anyone else a question? Maybe I even get bad ears, bad eyes meanwhile. So, so I have a couple of online questions. So if there's no questions in the room, I'm fine to continue with crafting the online questions. Is ECAL intended for deployment operation in series production and vehicles?
Sorry, what was the end of the question?
Is ECAL intended for deployment and operation in series production vehicles?
Currently not. The core is very small, as I mentioned, but it was never intended to use in series production. But it's a good, let's say, bridge technology in the pre-development phase to run your software components and to use the same code generators later on to bring these software components on a series plot. Possible. This is also the way that we do it internally right now. So we use the same components, the same component cores in the pre-development stage on ECAL, and by software code generation, we can embed these cores later on a system like whatever, adaptive autos or Apex or whatever is needed.
Great. I have a rather provocative question. How is this better than using MQTT? I'm just reading out loud what other typed in the chat, so.
Maybe we should measure the performance from MQTT, but we also use MQTT as a bridge technology, as a gateway for back-end communication, for having an HMI on AWS or something like this. This is the perfect use case for MQTT as a cloud service or something like this, but ECAL is really concentrating on high-performance communication.
I'm a Heinrich. Okay, wow. I have real problem with the stairs, so if I fall down, just don't care. Just go ahead with the conversation. And now it's getting very technical. I have no idea what this acronym is. Also, since we are using Protobuf, can we use gRPC with ECAL? I have no idea what gRPC is. Hopefully you know this.
Yes, for sure. So gRPC is a service interface provided directly from Google that can be generated out of these Protobuf files. But this is not integrated in ECAL. That makes not that much sense. You can create services out of your Protobuf description and use these services in ECAL, but ECAL has a separate service API based on ASIO, and it's not compatible to these services from Google.
Ansgar? You need to switch on the microphone.
Working on it? Okay. Thanks, Rex, for the presentation. Awesome. I'd like to understand, if you look at the ecosystem we are having in the Eclipse STV working group now, the different members we are having, the different perspectives, what maybe came or come from each of them, if you have one or two wishes free, what kind of contributions would you love to see in ECAL from whom?
Yeah, that is a good question. I was not prepared to this question.
Sorry.
For the ecosystem, what I can imagine first is there is a place in a pre-development stage. I mentioned this before. And here, a system like ECAL is really doing a good job for this, all this recording, monitoring, fast agile development of software components. And what I would like to see is something like a common code approach, code generator approach, where you can create components that would run on an ECAL system, for example, in the pre-development phase, but could also create software wrappers for other SDV middleware systems, like whatever will come up, and finally, for more serious use case, for more serious production use case. So on this level, we do not have any support. So we are like ROS, there's an ECAL, there's a ROS, there's an Adaptive Autosar, there's an Apex OS, and they are all slightly different. And I would love to see that we concentrate on a model-based code description for our software components, and we can generate these components for different systems and use these systems in different phases. That would be great.
Hi, also thanks for your presentation. I have a follow-up question to an answer you provided earlier. You said you use it also in the early development phase. My question is it also possible to run it faster or slower than real-time?
Yes, it is.
You use the timestamps?
Yeah, if you have this replay use case and you replay your measurement, then you can run it faster than real-time for sure. And there's one issue, this publish-subscribe pattern is loosely coupled. That means it's not fully deterministic. That means you can lose messages. You have a multi-threading, multi-processing system. So this is very often a drawback if you want to really validate a software component. But what you can do is there are adapter where your software components can read out directly the measured files without any publish-subscribe interface in between, and then you have a deterministic replay and it can run as fast your machine is possible to run, for sure.
Yeah, thanks. That was a bit what I was heading for, like if it is deterministic or
yeah,
if you have some kind of...
the drawback of all these systems. Yeah.
Okay.
I have another very deep technical question. Protobuf needs pre-compilation with protofile, right? Or can this be done dynamically on the fly as it seems in ECAL?
Yes, this is very tricky. Normally, yes, you need to pre-compile your interfaces based on your protobuf description. But what ECAL is doing is that you have, in the transport layer, you have two levels. One is just transporting the binary information, and on another layer, every publisher is providing a so-called descriptor information. And in the case of protobuf, this is a so-called dynamic protobuf descriptor, and this descriptor is available for all subscribers, also for the monitor, and this can be used then without compiling anything to have a dynamic reflection of the content of protobuf. So this is a specific technique from Google, it's called reflection, and if this is available for other formats too, then ECAL is automatically doing this reflection in the monitoring.
Then there's one more question. I can understand. What about security? Can any process listen in or on any topic?
Yes.
So.
This is a pre-development.
That's a short answer. Is there a long answer to this too?
This is because it's done for pre-development. We have a lot of power in introspection, and we can see everything. We can monitor everything, and the only solution here would be to use another system, maybe, or to say, okay, I secure my layer, I secure my Ethernet connections by another technique.
Yeah, and I may have another one word answer question. What is the maximum number of topics that can listen at the same time?
It's not restricted. It's just restricted by the system, by the resources from the system, number of memory files, number of sockets, things like that.
Okay. Well, that's mainly all of the questions from the chat. Are there any more questions from the room? Why I try to insist a little bit on questions is I would like to start the next presentation sharp. We have so many online participants, and we see that they're coming and going for individual presentations, so I don't want to start the next presentation early. Maybe from my side, how does ECAL connect to other technologies, like, let's say, existing Autosar, whatever? Since it's mainly, I understand, for development phase, maybe there's no connection at all. How does ECAL fit into the ecosystem of other components which are out there, and how does ECAL integrate into the ecosystem?
There are different options. As I mentioned, if you want to go to a cloud backend, then we use an MQTT, a generic MQTT gateway, for example. But if you want to communicate with an out-of-cell system, these approaches are so different, then we have no chance. We just need a gateway to communicate by some IP, by CAN or something like this. But in other use cases, like communicating with ROS2, there are also generic options. ECAL is also providing a ROS middleware layer for ROS2, so we can set up ROS2 on top of ECAL, for example, and then we have all the options. We can run a ROS system, but we can also do a parallel recording with ECAL in the background on the low layer. So different options for different systems, yeah.
Okay, and then maybe any other questions? Oh, there. Paulina, can you just that? So that is at least a fitness course for some of us today.
We need a microphone thrown.
So I'll repeat, thanks for the presentation, very nice. You started the presentation, said that ECAL is a very lightweight library that you can introduce. And I was kind of surprised that that's not being used in the real vehicle, serious production vehicle. The question that I have is this is pretty much what we need in the car. So that's not, so that's the reason why Apex is selling that Apex middleware, which is ROS-based too. So, is there any idea to make it or something similar to make it in the vehicle? Or can you tell something about that? I mean, perhaps not ECAL, but another system, open source, of course, within SDV.
Maybe it's a misunderstanding. So we use the system in all our prototyping cars. So we have a worldwide fleet of different trucks and robo-taxis and things like that. And all these cars are driven since years by ECAL, but not for serious production for sure. So if we go from pre-development into series, we try to use this code generator approach to say, okay, our software components needs to be developed with some restrictions to know, okay, later on we have to go to serious production, so no dynamic memory, no extra threading and things like that. And in the pre-development stage, they run on a system like ECAL in the real cars, and then there's a handover to serious production, and they take only the software component, they throw away all the ECAL stuff, and say, okay, now it will be rewrapped in a new system. So this is sort of the standard approach that we follow. But the system is fully in use, and we have tons of measurements from pre-development, yeah.
Maybe one final technical question. What is the speed compared to DDS today?
Oh, this is hard to answer, because everybody makes his own performance measurements, and they always win, depending from the author. So it is, ECAL has a zero copy mechanism, like Isorix has a 2, and Isorix and ECAL, they have more or less the same more or less the same performance. So the DDS system, like Cyclon DDS, is integrating Isorix for the local communication, so it's more or less depending on this low-level zero copy shared memory transport, and here we are in the same performance.
So comparable would be a fair answer?
Comparable, for sure.
Great. Okay, Greg, thanks a lot. Thanks for all the answers to these questions, one on high level, some on very technical levels.